Hi everyone, my name is Claudio De Santi. I am a distinguished engineer in the Chief Technology and Innovation Office Group at Dell Technologies. And today I will present about securing an NVMe over Fabrics IP fabric. Here's the agenda of what we will go through. First, we will begin with the fundamentals, the framework for SAM security, and then we will dig into the two fundamental security mechanisms defined for NVMe over Fabrics, for authentication and for secure chain. So let's begin with the SAM security framework. This is a very simple representation of a storage area network, in which we have typical elements of a storage area network, some host or servers that through the SAN are connected to a storage array, to some shared storage. And then there is a management station, a console, or a management console that is controlling the overall system. The storage in the storage array, as I said, is shared across the various hosts. And so inside the storage, we can see that there is a red partition intended to be accessed and used by the red host, a blue partition intended to be used by the blue host, and a green partition, which is intended to be used by the green host. So let's take a look. What are the security threats to this configuration? First, security threat. There could be an attack to the management system integrity of your management console. And I call this threat zero because if your point of control of the overall system will get accessed, all other pods are lost. Of course, the system can be accessed in every other part. So this is really threat zero that we need to look at. Then we have uncontrolled storage access. As we said, the red host has some red storage, which is associated to it. And the red host might try to access the blue storage. A variant of that is impersonation. In order to avoid potential controls that avoid uncontrolled storage access, the green host might declare itself to the storage as I am blue, I'm not green, in order to try to access the blue storage. That is another important security threat, impersonation. And we can see this interesting character that gets a communication access to the SAN itself, to the network itself. This means that this character is able to analyze all the traffic, eavesdrop the traffic that is going on, and possibly also to modify this traffic or inject traffic that was not intended to be there. This is another fundamental security threat. Finally, we have external access to the media itself. As an example, theft of the media inside the storage array or other kinds of access. So these are the fundamental threats you can see that are present in every storage. Let's go to analyze each of them and see how it is possible to resolve or mitigate these threats. Security threat zero, access to the management console. Well, there are some fairly standard countermeasures over there because this is not a problem which is typical or just present in a SAN. In every system, if an attacker is able to access your control, consider your control system, basically the attacker is able to get full access to that system. So there is a set of standard measures that can be applied also here. Management security, how to control the access to the management console. So every access should be authenticated and properly authorized. Logging of every activity that happens to the management console should happen, and anomaly detection techniques can be adopted to figure out if something strange is going on. And of course, secure all channels that enable to access the management console itself. Another important countermeasure is the system integrity of the management console itself, to be sure that hardware, software, and firmware is not compromised. And this is preferably anchored to a hardware of trust. While, as I say, this is a fundamental threat and needs to be addressed, there is actually nothing specific to a storage area network about this threat. This is, as I said, very common to every system in which there is a point of management. So we will not come back again to this point because, again, it's a common thing to every system. Let's look instead now to security threat one, specific for Sun, uncontrolled storage access. The red host tries to access the blue storage. And this is the countermeasure for this is storage access control. In Fiber Channel, this is called zoning. In SCSI, it's called LAN masking, or in NVMe, we have namespace mapping. A way on the fabric to limit access, and a way on the storage array itself to be able to say, okay, this is the storage partition for the blue host, only the blue host can access this storage partition and not the red host. So this is the countermeasure for this threat. However, there is a variant of this one. The problem of this threat is that this countermeasure, storage access control, does not prevent impersonation. And impersonation is the next security threat. The green storage declares itself to the storage array as I am blue, and so I want to access the blue storage. The green host, sorry. The countermeasure for this is authentication, so which is a proof of identity. Think to this similarly to when you enter the United States and you are going through an immigration officer. The immigration officer has to verify your identity, and you have with you a proof of identity, which is your passport, typically. And that is what gets verified. And if the verification is successful, you are granted access to the country. Otherwise, you cannot access. It is very similar. Proof of identity happens on the basis of something which is associated, in this case, only to the blue host. This enables the blue host to authenticate to the storage, and so guarantee that I am really blue, so you can give me access to the blue storage. Green will not have the same proof of identity, and in this way, the impersonation threat is resolved. Then we have the communication access, the possibility for someone or something to access the communication across the SAN itself. The countermeasure is a secure channel, something that is able to provide cryptographic integrity and cryptographic confidentiality to every data that is in flight. And so here we are thinking about encryption and integrity of every packet that is exchanged between host and storage device to be sure that nothing has been changed while in flight, nothing has been added, and nothing has been removed. This is a well-known secure countermeasure for this threat. And finally, we have the security threat 4, which is access to the storage data, to the stored data. And the way in which these can be counterbalanced is encryption of the stored data itself. So encryption for data at rest. This is something that can be implemented at the application layer, on the server OS, or the guest of a virtual machine OS, can be implemented by an advisor, or can be implemented by the storage drive itself. We have the self-encrypting drives. This is another technique that basically enables to counterbalance the possible threat of accessing the stored data. So let's go to a review of where we are. We have management system integrity is a possible threat, storage access control, authentication, or a secure channel for data in flight, and store data encryption. So these are the ways in which we are able to counterbalance all these threats that we find in a storage related environment. The focus of the subsequent discussion will be now on authentication, proof of identity, and on secure channel for an NVMe over Fabrics IP network. So let's get into the NVMeOF security authentication. Let's start with a comparison of the security mechanism that has been defined for various storage protocols. So for authentication, let's compare iSCSI Fibre Channel and NVMe over Fabrics using the IP protocol. iSCSI defined two mechanisms for authentication, CHAP, Challenge Shake Authentication Protocol, and SRP. CHAP is based on a strong secret, SRP can have a password, so a weaker secret. In practice, SRP is not used. CHAP is the only mechanism that are being deployed in iSCSI. In Fibre Channel, many authentication protocols have been defined. DHCHAP, an improved version of CHAP, SCPAP, FCAP, FCEAP. Although many has been defined, the only one that I found some deployment has been actually the DHCHAP, the improved version of CHAP that was defined for Fabric. For NVMe over Fabrics, there is one authentication protocol that has been defined, and it is GHH matchup, all still based on strong secret, as any CHAP. And it's basically a further enhanced version of the CHAP protocol that was initially used with iSCSI. So let's go to see the details of how an authentication transaction happens in NVMeOF. Here we see a host and a controller that are connected together. Let's consider they are using the TCP transport. A host connect to a controller, establish a TCP session. After a TCP session is established, the NVMe protocol issue the connect command, and the controller will respond to the host with a connect response. This is an important command because enable to exchange the identities of the two parties, set up the NVMe queue, and associate the host and to the controller. This is the point in which, depending on the content of the connect response, an authentication transaction may be required. And so this is where, immediately after the initial connect, the host and the controller may authenticate each other. Once the authentication transaction is completed, the queue is set up and ready for subsequent operations, and the two parties have been authenticated. What are the characteristics in this process of the DHCHAP matchup protocol? It is defined in the NVMe 2.0 base specification, formerly was in technical proposal 8006. It is based on keys that are different per each NQM. Remember that in NVMe, each entity, each host, or each controller, or each storage device is identified by a unique NVMe qualified name, or NQN. So the key is now associated to the NQN. The NQN is the identity, is the name of each entity. And as we said, the purpose of authentication is verify that the claim identity is true. The way to verify this identity is to verify that if a certain entity that claims to have a certain NQN has the keys which is associated to that NQN. So each NQN in an NVMe fabric is associated with a unique key, and the authentication protocol is verify that NQN knows that key. The protocol itself is a challenge response protocol. So the authenticator will send a challenge, see? The responder computes a response R, which is a hash of this challenge, and the key of the responder, and other things. And the authenticator receives the response and verifies the response, or can delegate verification to a centralized authentication verification facility. So this is the basic CHAP protocol. How is the HECMA-CHAP different? It's a strengthened of the version of CHAP by adding a Diffie-Hellman exchange. So it's an additional key exchange that enables to frustrate instructors and uses a hashed MAC rather than a basic hash. So use a secure hash twice in order to improve the overall security of the protocol. And the protocol allows to achieve bidirectional authentication. Let's see how we get bidirectional authentication. Because as I said, it is a challenge response protocol. So each challenge gets a response. And so we have a unidirectional challenge response. Well, we can look at here. The protocol begins with an unnegotiator. We'll come back to that, why it begins in that way. At this point, the controller starts the real challenge protocol with a message which is called DHECMACHAP challenge. And here the controller will send a challenge, C1. Here it is. The host receives this C1, computes a response R1, which is based is an HMAC function of the key of the host of the challenge that has been received, concatenated with other things. At this point, the response R1 is sent back in a reply to the controller. Here is the response R1. And the controller, see, verifies the response. In this way, the controller has sent a challenge to the host replied, the controller verifies the response, the controller authenticates the host. So we got a first authentication, a unidirectional authentication. How do we get the other piece? How do we get the host to authenticate the controller? It is here in this reply message, the host can send a challenge C2. So, okay, controller, you sent me a challenge. Here is my response. I send you a challenge. I want your response. So the host can send a challenge C2. The controller C computes a response, which is again an HMAC using the key of the controller of the challenge C2 that has been received, concatenated with other things. And at this point, the host H receives the response and verifies the response. If the response is the verification is successful, the host also authenticated the controller. So this is how two unidirectional authentications are able to generate a bidirectional authentication. In terms of verification, well, the controller needs to compute a different by itself, R1, and verifies if it matches the receiver. The host computer R2 prime, check if it matches the receiver R2. So this is the way. And here we have the full mathematical system, and we will come back to that in a moment. But we'll look again at the protocol and what goes in all the parameters of the various messages. The protocol itself has been designed to be extensible. So the first message is a generic message. We call it auto negotiate, in which we carry a transaction ID that basically enables to identify everything that is happening here. All messages will carry this transaction ID. One flag about secure channel concatenation, we'll go back to that one later. And then says, oh, and I want to use the HMACHAP protocol. This is authentication protocol ID. This is done to enable the definition of future authentication protocols if in the future more will be needed. And then we'll have a list of possible hash identifiers that can be used in this authentication transaction, and a list of possible Diffie-Hellman group identifiers that can be used in this authentication transaction. The controller gets this. The controller selects the authentication protocol to use, in this case, the HMACHAP. Only one has been defined so far. Selects which hash will be used. So it provides the hash ID selects which Diffie-Hellman group will be used, and so provide here an ID, and then we go into the fundamentals of the protocol with a sequence number, the challenge, which is the fundamental argument, and the first exponential of the Diffie-Hellman exchange, g to the x mod p. In the reply of the host, we get the response to the challenge, and the second part of the Diffie-Hellman exponential, g to the y modulus p. Then you see here in square brackets, stu and ctu. The host can send a sequence number stu and a challenge ctu in order to perform the authentication of the controller. But authentication of the controller is kind of optional in the protocol. That's why this is in square brackets. It might be just the controller who wants to authenticate the host. The host doesn't need to authenticate the controller. If that is the case, these parameters will not be present in the message. Otherwise, they are there, and we get to full bidirectional authentication. And again, here, when the controller receives CTU, we will get then the response RTU that comes in the first success message. And if the verification of the response RTU by the host is successful as well, in the second success message, with the second success message, we close the protocol and the authentication transaction is successful. And if you look at the full mathematics that has been developed for the protocol, you can see that there are many more parameters in respect to what was done for the original CHAP that done in IceGuard. We have an HMAC using the key of the host of an augmented challenge, which is augmented from the original challenge using the session key generated by the Diffie-Hellman exchange, concatenated with the sequence number, the transaction ID, the secure channel concatenation flag, the string host-host, if you are a host, and then the NQN of the host and the controller that are involved. And if instead you are a controller, you will have here the string controller and the NQN of the controller and the host that are involved in there. All these parameters are put here to make the protocol significantly stronger than the basic CHAP. And so these are the fundamentals of the DHHMACHAP protocol. As I said, the way in which this is working, you need a key that is used to compute the responses. And how these keys are provided to the various NVMe entities, to host and controller, to host and storage subsystems. What we provide are secrets. We define the protocol providing secrets that are provisioned and then transformed by each entity into keys that are used by the protocol. And we standardized a secret interchange ASCII format. We'll have this format in ASCII, so it's easy to copy and paste from a screen to another, as an example of a video. So DHHC-1, first version of a DHHMACHAP secret, basically, an XX to identify the hash function to transform the secret in a key, and then we have a base64 encoded string. And how do we go from this secret to a key? We go to an HMAC of the secret with the, using the secret that is passed as the HMAC key. And then what is processed by the HMAC function is the identity of the entity concatenated with the string NVMe over fabrics to add some entropy to the overall process. And of course, the value 0 on this set of values identifies the identity function, and so it's a way to provision directly keys into the entity. So an NVMe entity for authentication needs to be provisioned with its own secret. And for verification, in order to compute for the controller R1 prime, for the host R2 prime, for verification needs to know the key of the other entity. Centralized authentication verification drastically simplifies the provisioning process because only the entity secret needs to be provisioned, no other keys. So this concludes the explanation of the DHHMACHAP protocol. Let's now go to the secure channel piece of NVMe over Fabric Secure. In our table that compares the security mechanism, now we are looking at the secure channel piece. In iSCSI, IPsec is what has been defined and used typically in security gateways, not on an end-to-end standpoint. In Fibre Channel, we define the ESP header, which is IPsec-like, but got very limited usage in practice. In NVMe over Fabrics, we define the use of TLS for TCP, which is something controlled by the NVMe protocol. And you can also use IPsec, but IPsec is completely transparent to NVMe because it is much lower in the stack. And so it is a possible option, but it's not something that we will go through here because there is nothing special about using IPsec with NVMe is as using with any other protocol. As we say here in iSCSI, in security gateways. Okay, can do the same thing. So let's look at the TLS and that usage that has been specified for NVMe over Fabric. TLS, Transport Layer Security, is a widely used secure channel protocol. Every time today you are doing a Google search, your traffic is encrypted and secured using TLS. Or every time you connect to your bank, you have the same. Everything is encrypted and secured and cryptographically protected from for integrity using the TLS protocol. And the typical web usage is that as the server uses a certificate with TLS and the client authenticates after the TLS setup. Instead, for NVMe TCP, we are based on pre-share keys, PSKs. We have different TLS versions. TLS 1 and 1.1 are obsolete, shall not be used. 1.2 is what is most used right now, but is being more and more replaced by TLS 1.3, which is the latest and greatest version. Fundamentally, a complete protocol redesign, and there is a lot of support, which is available right now in multiple security libraries. And as we speak, this support is increasing. NVMe TCP specifies the user of TLS 1.3 as part of the NVMe TCP transport specification, part of the NVMe 2.0 set of specification. It was defined in technical proposal 8011. TLS is important, is not specified for other NVMe OF IP-based protocol, as an example for Rocky V2, because it's specified for TCP-based protocols. So it's specified only for the TCP protocol. NVMe TCP tier had previously specified in the NVMe OF 1.1 standard the usage of TLS 1.2, but technical proposal 8011 strongly discouraged the use of TLS 1.2 because it, despite various potential interoperability issues and security holes, we found also implementation limitations on the maximum identity size that make problematic its support. Basically, very common TLS 1.2 implementations have the identity size limited to 127 bytes, while the identity that has been defined for the NVMe protocol is the concatenation of the NQNs that of the two involved entities. And an NQN can be up to 224 bytes. So there is no way to fit in the general case in 127 bytes. This is the reason why TLS 1.2 is strongly discouraged. It has been not fully obsoleted, but the focus is use TLS 1.3. There are also other reasons to work on TLS 1.3. TLS 1.2, you look at the IANA, TLS registry has more than 300 ciphers with code points, with uncertain security properties and difficult interoperability. TLS 1.3, 5 cipher suites, all with perfect focal secrecy and modern algorithms, which ensure consistent security properties. TLS 1.2 encryption starts late in the handshake. Instead, in TLS 1.3, starts as early as possible, hiding content length. And TLS 1.2 has many features with known security flaws. All these features have been omitted from TLS 1.3. How does a TLS 1.3, then secure channel establishment operate with NVMe over Fabrics. But we have our host and controller, as said before. And now, rather than having a TCP session that gets established, what we will have will be a TLS session get established. TCP and TLS session get established. So over here, there will be the connect command performed to set up the NVMe queue and associate the host to the controller. And here we are fine. But basically, all the traffic, once the TLS secure channel has been established, is encrypted and cryptographically protected. So the connect command is encrypted and cryptographically protected, and any other traffic is encrypted and cryptographically protected as appropriate for a secure channel. So this is the way in which TLS 1.3 enables to ensure security, a secure channel in NVMe over Fabrics. What is one problem that we have? As I said, the TLS secure channel for NVMe TCP is based on pre-shared keys. The only way to have these pre-shared keys working right is that per each pair of entities that can communicate, I need to have a specific PSK. Oftentimes, so in order to establish a secure channel between themselves, two NVMe entities needs to be configured with the same PSK. Often we saw that these led to a deployment option called group PSKs. The administrator just configured the same PSK on all NVMe entities. But this is a big security concern. And remember, why are we doing this? We are doing this to achieve security. But if we use the same secret everywhere, the same PSK everywhere, it's basically the same thing as like you are using the same password in all your accounts. Okay, if one account gets compromised, all your accounts get compromised. You know very well that this is not a good practice. So we need to have one PSK per each pair of entities that can communicate. And this is now an N square problem to treat. We have many PSK to manage. So we defined a way to try to resolve this point by leveraging the authentication protocols. Because as we said, a DHEC matchup transaction can also have a Diffie-Hellman exchange that is running as part of the transaction. The Diffie-Hellman exchange is able to generate an ephemeral shared session key. So basically a PSK which is computed on the fly. Once then I compute this PSK, now the TLS negotiation can be performed using a PSK that is derived from that share key. So there is no more need for a group PSK. From an implementation result, the TCP connection begins unsecure and then transitions to secured. This is something that is used already as an example in SMTP and is called opportunistic TLS. Now, what we got by doing this thing, we are back to a linear problem in terms of provisioning. Think you are basically reusing the provisioning of secrets for your authentication protocol to also enable secure channels. And once you have a centralized authentication verification, you just need one secret per entity. And so the provisioning problem becomes drastically simplified by using this concatenation system. So how would it work to have an authentication followed by TLS? A TCP session get established. Then at this point, as in every NVMe queue establishment, a connect command is sent and a connect response is received. And so the queue is set up, the host is associated to the controller. Then we have an authentication transaction that generates a PSK. And this PSK is used to establish a secure channel between the host and the controller. Now we are fine. The secure channel is established and the queue is set up. We are ready for subsequent operations. This is how the system works. And how are all these keys generated? This is a way in which we see everything starts from the Diffie-Hellman exchange that generates the session key during the DHEC matchup protocol. the fiat-money exchange is used to augment the challenges that are exchanged, and then to compute the responses for DHL matchup, so for the authentication protocol. And is also used to generate the PSK for TLS. And look that while in order to compute the responses for the authentication protocol, each what is used is what is coming from only one of the two parties. In order to generate the PSK for TLS, we do an HMAC using the session key of the concatenation of the two challenges that has been sent by the two parties. And so we basically take two random numbers coming from two different points in order to achieve the maximum entropy as a source of this HMAC function to generate a highly entropic PSK for the TLS secure channel setup. So we arrived at the end of this session. I hope you found it interesting and useful. Key takeaways: the NVMe 2.0 set of specifications include a comprehensive security architecture. This architecture defines protocol to address the fundamental SAN security threats of authentication, proof of identity, and secure channel to protect data in flight. And the protocols that have been defined is the authentication protocol, DHL matchup, and the secure channel protocol, which is how to leverage TLS 1.3 in an NVMe OF environment based on IP. With this, this session is completed. Thank you very much for watching it. Please take a moment to rate this session. Thank you so much.